I'm willing to bet this. I'm willing to bet that you can't remember the last time you heard a sermon on Zephaniah. Yeah, people are like, huh? Zephaniah? Yeah, like he's one of the 12 minor prophets. And there's a reason why guys like me don't preach a lot of sermons on Zephaniah to all of you. And the reason we don't preach a lot of sermons on Zephaniah is not because it's a long book. It's not long. It's just 3 chapters. It's not because it's complicated to understand, because Zephaniah is pretty straightforward. Ah, there it is. That's the problem. Zephaniah, that's the problem. Zephaniah is straightforward.
Amen.
He is direct.
Amen.
And he is strong. And maybe too strong for what we want to hear. Zephaniah brings us, yes, a message about a mighty God who is able to save, but he also brings us a strong sense of the need to repent. Zephaniah is like some of his other contemporary minor prophets. He's upset with Israel, Judea, and Jerusalem. Okay? Now, in order to understand why Zephaniah is upset, I'm going to take the first part of the sermon and just sort of review with you the history of Israel after the rise of Israel as a nation, and David and Saul and all of that situation happened. I just need to review that so we can get context, because Zephaniah is really upset.
Amen.
So as we know, originally there was Israel, right? And Israel was one nation, and then a division happened. Okay, we had Saul was called to be the first king after Samuel was the prophet. After the judges was Samuel, and Samuel was the prophet. And then, you know, Saul became king, but really David was his choice. We remember that story. And then we remember that what happened is David gave the kingdom to his son, Saul. And then it got messy. Now, when David was king, this is one thing that happened that's important. When David was king, God said in Judah, there will always be a king on the throne after David's lineage, because the Messiah comes from Judah. He is the Lion of Judah, right?
Amen.
And so God had promised that the Messiah would always come from Judah. But after Saul, there was a split between Judah and Israel. And just as Christians in general, we don't often think about that split. We often, as Christians in general, just think of Judah and Israel as being one nation. But they weren't until after Babylon. So between Solomon and Babylon, they were actually two kingdoms. The two kings got in a dispute over finances. Go figure, right? And 10 tribes said, fine, if Judah thinks they're all important because they got Jerusalem and that's the capital, we're going to go north. And the 10 tribes broke off and became their own nation. They had their own king. And actually, they had their own temples or their own places of worship. So on my map, you know, it shows Judah, and it shows that in Jerusalem there was a place of worship. And in Israel, there were two different places of worship. And maybe we can pull the map back up for a second so that the audience can see. I just want to point this out. In those two different places, in Israel, Bethel and Dan, they had two different temples. And I actually visited the temple that was in Dan, or the worship site that was in Dan. And I actually spent time right in that circle looking at the ruins that are there. They have excavated this. And in Israel, they put two temples of golden calves. and they called it Yahweh. And when you go to the one in Dan, that's certainly what I went to, you can see the remnants there. In Judah, kept the temple of Yahweh, but they didn't always do right either. And so these two nations split, and as these two nations split, you can see that they had their own succession of kings. Okay, of the two, because Israel had put those two temples in Beth and Dan and put a golden calf in them and called that golden calf Yahweh, obviously they became corrupt first, right? And so Assyria came and captured Israel, but Judah remained a little bit more faithful. Of those two kingdoms, you will just see that five kings remained faithful in the history of Judah between Solomon all the way to Babylonian captivity. Five kings remained faithful, but in Israel, no kings remained faithful. Well, and it kind of figures, right? Because you got that, you know, you got those temples there, right? So people forget quickly what they believe. And then Israel falls first. It's wiped out first. The Assyrians come and they capture Israel. But then Judah also gets wiped out when the Babylonians come. Okay? Now, there's dark times in Judah, and this is the context of Zephaniah. Okay? So Israel has already fallen. And Zephaniah takes place at a time where apostasy after apostasy has happened. Israel is gone, and we're down into the toenails of Judah, which means Judah is also about to fall. We're just years away from that fall. And if you look at the last minutes of Judah's history, you see King Hezekiah. And you see that he had the prophets Isaiah and Micah. King Hezekiah actually happens to be related to Zephaniah. So Zephaniah could be king, but he's not. He's prophet. Josiah is king in the time of Zephaniah. But notice there are only two kings after Josiah. And then what happens? Captivity. Right? So why am I telling you all this? I'm telling you all this to show you that there has been hundreds of years of corruption going on. Hundreds of years of worshiping golden calves. Hundreds of years of worshiping the gods of Baal and the foreign gods of the nations. And that it's at that time that Josiah becomes king. And it's at that time Zephaniah becomes prophet. And you can understand why Zephaniah is angry at Judah. Because they already have seen what happened to Israel. Assyria came and captured them for their disobedience. And they had prophet after prophet come to Israel and say, if you don't repent, you are going to go into captivity. But Israel did not heed, and Assyria sacked Israel. Now, the last part that's faithful is Judah. And Judah is now worshiping Baals. And Zephaniah comes along not only to talk to Judah, but to talk to Jerusalem. In essence, Zephaniah is saying to Jerusalem, even you? Yeah, we get that Israel fell. They had two temples, two golden calves. We get that. We get that Judah's corrupt. But even you, Jerusalem, you have the temple of Yahweh. And even you are worshiping the Baals and the Asherah poles now. The gods of the Canaanites, the god of the Philistines. You even Jerusalem? It's even worse. They're worshiping the gods of Baal, and they're worshiping the gods of Asherah, and they're worshiping the other pagan gods of the region, and they're worshiping him in the temple in Jerusalem. They are, in essence, creating the same sin that their northern brothers did and saying, aha, this is really Yahweh. And so Zephaniah is preaching at a time when no one will listen. They don't know their left from their right. They go to the temple to worship, but who are they worshiping there? No one will listen. And time is almost up. Babylon is coming. But a child shall lead them. And Josiah, who becomes king at age 8, like 1 year older than my little boy, he becomes king. And at 8 years old, how is he going to solve this problem? How is he going to deal with this problem? Well, you heard about it in the children's story, right? He actually listens to Zephaniah. Understand, these two beings exist at the same time in the same area. The capital of Judah is Jerusalem. And Zephaniah is a prophet to Jerusalem. And Zephaniah is telling Jerusalem, you have to stop worshiping the Baals. You have to stop worshiping Asherah. You have to stop worshiping the other gods of the region. And this little 8-year-old begins to listen. So I want to just say to any of the children watching today, you can impact the spirituality of even your home. You can make a difference amongst your friends. You do have a reach of influence. Josiah is just an 8-year-old king, and he begins to make reforms, and he sends them to the temple, and he's like, what is going on with the temple? Why are we worshiping these other gods who are not Yahweh? And they begin to dig around in the temple, and they found the book of the law, which means Moses, right? And they're like, start reading Moses, and they start reading things, the Lord your God is one. And they're like, oh boy. And they start reading about coming up out of Egypt and being liberated, and that they're supposed to keep Passover in honor of the fact that they have been liberated. And they're like, ooh, we've not done that either. So Josiah goes ahead, and he not only starts taking down the idols, starts taking down the temples, starts cleaning out the temple literally, and reinstituting Passover, he becomes a good king on a spiritual journey to lead believers back into a truthful faith. But he's one king in a nation that is rebellious. Now listen. It takes more than a good leader to change the culture of a nation. It takes more than a good leader to change the culture of a church. You can't depend on just the pastor to be able to do that. And so Josiah was a good king, but the people could follow his dictates. They could follow his rules. They could have Passover because the king said, we got to have Passover. But that doesn't put their passion into their Passover. And it's one thing to do what's right because the king tells you to do what's right. It's another thing to do what's right because you believe it's what's right. And remember, one day they were over there worshiping to the Baals in the temple of God, and shortly after that, they're having Passover. Josiah was a good king with a bad ending. And that's the part the children's story left out. When Egypt and Cush decided to go to war with Assyria, you would think, I mean, I'm just talking logically here, you would think that the king of Judah would be, okay, that's all right, because Assyria is the one who took my brothers captive. But instead, Josiah begins to wonder, wait, they're going to pass right through my land. Maybe they're going to take me too. At that point, he should have inquired of the Lord. But without the word of the Lord, Josiah goes out to war against the Egyptians. Maybe because he just read about the Lord delivering them from Egypt. I don't know. But he does it without a word from God. Listen, don't you take on a fight that God hasn't told you to take on.
Amen.
Don't you go out to war against someone that God has not sent you out to war against.
Amen.
You better make sure you're in the right fight if you want to be in a fight that God's going to fight with you, because God doesn't fight in wrong fights.
Amen.
Don't ask yourself, is God on my side? Ask yourself, am I on God's side?
Amen.
Because Josiah was a good king. But he assumed God was on his side. Rather than asking God, am I on your side? And this led to a conflict. And that conflict led to Zephaniah being a lone voice, speaking to rebellious people who aren't interested in Yahweh. Unless they're ordered to be. Come on, Seventh-day Adventists. There's a lesson there for you. Your king, your governor, your president cannot dictate your faith. We cannot pass laws to make right things happen. People must do right things out of conscience, right? And that's why we were happy about Memorial Day, because people sacrifice for our liberty, and we have liberty. But Zephaniah found out that when Josiah went away, the people went back to their old habits. In fact, it got worse. In Zephaniah chapter 1, verse 5... Zephaniah tells Jerusalem that God will strike them because they are those who bow and worship on their rooftops to the stars in the sky. They are those who bow and pledge their loyalty to the Lord Yahweh, but also their loyalty to Moloch. Now, hold on here, folks. Moloch. Does that voice ring anything in your mind? Moloch. The Baals are bad. Asherah is bad. I mean, worshiping anything other than Yahweh is not right.
Amen.
But Moloch, the worship of Moloch involves sacrificing your children on the altar instead of a lamb, instead of a bull, instead of a pigeon. Your children. Do you begin to understand why Zephaniah is a book of strict judgment? Do you understand why Zephaniah is a book of strict adherence and demands for a prophet who is irate? You see, they had just read when the book of the law was found in the temple and Josiah was alive. They had just read about how God had worshipped, or God had freed them from the Egyptians and told them that the Passover saved their firstborn sons, right? That's what Passover is all about. That's what they just celebrated, was Passover with Josiah. And immediately after Josiah is gone, they say, no, Yahweh didn't cover our firstborn sons. We must sacrifice them to Moloch. And so you don't hear a lot of sermons on the book of Zephaniah. Because Zephaniah brings a strong message. And the book of Zephaniah is broken up into three segments. This is not directly related to what I'm going to tell you. I'm going to be preaching mostly on the last segment. But I want you to have all the context for when you hear what God is going to say. The first is that the army is coming. Judgment is on Jerusalem. It is too late for you, Jerusalem. You have ignored the reforms of Josiah, and you have went ahead when he taught you to keep Passover again. You chose Moloch and sacrificing your sons instead. And part two is, you're not just guilty, Jerusalem. So are all the nations around them, because this is where you got the corruption from. But part three is going to be our focus today. Part three is, No matter how bad you get, no matter how sinful you are, no matter what your problem, God will find a way to save a remnant from you. You are still treasured by God. And so in Zephaniah chapter 3 and verse 1 and 2, Zephaniah is giving his last rebuke to the behavior of Jerusalem. He's just finished comparing their behavior to the nations of which they got their new religion from. And he says, woe to her who is rebellious and defiled. She's what? Rebellious and defiled. This is why this is not a popular book to preach. Woe to you! Woe to her! Woe to those who are rebellious and defiled. The opposing city, she listens to no voice. She won't heed the prophets. She won't heed her own history. She listens to no voice. She accepts no correction. She does not trust the Lord. And she does not draw near to her God. You see, Zephaniah is not the first prophet to preach this. Prophets preached this for hundreds of years in Israel as they worshiped golden calves and called it Yahweh. And then prophets preached it in Judah after Israel was captive. But now we're down to Jerusalem. Now we're down to what should be the Holy of Holies. Now we're down to the city and the town where the priests should live. Now we're down to the place where everyone should be coming for Passover and the other festivals. And they too will not listen to their God. They too will not listen to their God. And so Zephaniah says, punishment must come to Judah now. Babylon will now come to Judah. And Babylon will now come not only to Judah, but Babylon will also come to Jerusalem itself. Babylon will also take the temple itself. I hope you're understanding the historical significance of this. The last true temple of Yahweh on the planet is about to be overtaken by pagan heathen hands. And the people of God can't even wake up to notice how serious the hour of God is. Wow. This is why this is not a popular book to preach. Because it's not hard to make correlations between the time of Zephaniah and the time of us. How long has it been since the great reformer Josiah or the Protestant Reformation? We all wanted to make our religion and faith right according to the Bible. Are we not being like Judah? Are we not being like Jerusalem? Are we not going through the motions of pretending to be spiritual? Pretending that we're worshiping Yahweh when in fact we're worshiping all the other gods? If God punished Jerusalem itself in this way, what about Christianity? There is a reason this is not a popular book to preach from. But I want to tell you something else. Zephaniah's name means treasured by God. In fact, if I can break it down just a little bit more, Zephaniah's name means literally hidden by God. Now, not hidden like in the way of concealed, not hidden as in, you know, I will take this flower and put it in my pocket so you can't see it. It's not hidden as in terms of concealed. It's hidden as in valuable, not common of God. It's not easy to see it. It's like maybe like a diamond ring, like maybe a poor person's diamond ring. Like there's a diamond there someplace. It's small. It's treasured. Seventh-day Adventist, it's remnant. You know that word, remnant. Zephaniah's name means there's something still here in Jerusalem. There's something still here in Judah. There's something still here that I treasure. Oh, I know you let Israel fall. Oh, I know you had the opportunity to go to let Egypt liberate Israel from Egypt, but you instead went to war against Egypt. Oh, I know the last reform failed. But there's still something here I want to treasure. There's still something here that is important to me. And so suddenly in the third chapter of the book of Zephaniah, in the third act of the book of Zephaniah, Zephaniah does not cool his anger. Zephaniah does not take away the pending conflict. I mean, we know the end of the story. Babylon does come to Jerusalem, right? But Zephaniah reminds them before that captivity that you still have a God who loves you. You still have a God who treasures you. There may be hard days ahead of you, Judah. There may be hard days ahead of you, Judah. But there is still a God in your corner. And in verse 12, he begins to say, but I will leave in your midst. I will leave in your midst a humble people, a lowly people, and they shall seek refuge from the name of the Lord. The judgment is still coming. Babylon is still coming. You're still going to be sacked. You're still going to be punished. I mean, you have to be punished. You sacrificed your children to Moloch. That can't go unanswered. People cannot say that's what the religion of Yahweh is. But even though I will raise up out of your ashes a humble people, I will raise up out of your ashes a lowly people. And the next verse is amazing. He says, not only will I raise it up, but I will sing. Sing aloud, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O Israel. Rejoice and be exalted with your heart, O daughter of Jerusalem. Watch this. Verse 15. The Lord has taken what? Away the judgments against you. He has cleared the way. He has cleared away your enemies. The king of Jerusalem. The king of Judah. And he uses the word Israel, signifying when this comes true, the two divided kingdoms will be one. The kingdom of Israel. I am the king. Jesus is the king, is what he's saying. Zephaniah is prophesying of the king that will come and unite the nation, right? This is a prophecy that Jeremiah will pick up. Yes, they're going to be punished. Yes, they're going to go into captivity. But there will be a time when God remembers the hidden treasure in Babylon. There will be time when a remnant in Babylon rise up and call out to God, just like there was in Egypt. The Lord will take away the judgments at that time. He will clear the way of your enemies. He will finally be the king in Israel. In your midst, and you shall never fear evil again. On that day, see, the day's not yet. On that day, it shall be said to Jerusalem, fear not, O Zion. Zion is traditionally the name of Israel. See, this is a unifying statement. On that day, the two divided kingdoms will be unified, and Yahweh will be the unifier. On that day, it should be said to Jerusalem, fear not, O Zion. Let not your hands grow weak. Zephaniah is calling for a day of the future. Zephaniah is calling for a day when Jerusalem will be called the daughter again. And Zion will be cherished again, and they will be unified again. Zephaniah is telling them, yes, Babylon is coming. Yes, two more kings and then Babylon. But don't worry, Jeremiah will tell you it's only going to be for 70 years. And I'm telling you that when those 70 years are over, God will look and remember that you are hidden treasure that he still values. Then comes verse 17. From our scripture reading. The Lord your God. Lord, all in capitals, which means in Hebrew, Yahweh your God is with you even in captivity. The Lord your God is with you even when you have failed him to the ultimate level. You may have forsaken Yahweh. You may have chased after other gods. You may have sank to the lowest of the lowest. But he is mighty to save. He has not forgotten you in Babylon. He has not forgotten you when you're in captivity. He's not forgotten you when the consequences of your own repeated bad behavior that he called you away from take hold of you and bring you to a place you never wanted. In fact, he said that's when he can use you, because he will be looking for a humble people, he said. Didn't he? He said, I'll be looking for a lowly people. Didn't he? He said he'd be looking for these people. He said he will take great delight. He will quiet you with his love. Listen to this. He will rejoice over you with singing. Now, we sing praises to God. They were talking about online, Marvin, about us singing praises to God and how great the praises to God was. But listen to this verse. God will sing to us. I mean, we're always singing to God, and it's such an honor to sing to God. But this verse actually says there's a time coming when you've reached the lowest of low, when you got no more song left because you're so corrupt and so dirty and so destroyed. Wow. That God will be mighty to save. He will remember his hidden treasure. He will quiet you with his love. You will know you're undeserving. After all you've did, you will ask questions like, how could God save me? Why would God save me? Why would God come to a sinner as wretched as me? After all, I've been to the temple of the Baals and to the Astropoles and even Moloch. But God's answer to your sin problem, listen, God's answer to your sin problem is that he doesn't care how bad it got. He wants to sing love over you. And the song he wants to sing to you is, I am mighty, I am able. And the word mighty or able literally means, I am your hero. I am your warrior. So we could think of the verse as saying this, literally, when you can't help yourself, when you are down so far, when you have sunken to the level where you think, God could never forgive me. God would never want me again. Stop and hear him sing to you. Maybe you're there this morning. Stop and listen to your hero. Your hero is singing. Verse 19. Behold, at that time, I will deal with your oppressors. Behold, at that time, I will deal with the Baals in your life. Behold, at that time, I will take down the Asherah poles in your life. Behold, at that time, I can even free you from Moloch. And I will save the lame, and I will gather the outcast. You see, it's the lowly, the humble, the broken, the lame, the outcast. And I will change their shame. Oh, I want that, don't you? I will change their shame into praise. I will re-own in all the earth. At that time, I will bring you, at that time, I will gather you up out of Babylon. At that time, I will make you renowned. Renowned. And I will make you praised among all the peoples of the earth. when I restore you and the fortunes before your eyes, says God. Listen, don't think you can never be used. Maybe there's a hard judgment on you right now. There could be. And I know it's not popular to say such things. It's not popular to preach from the book of Zephaniah, but it's right there. It's in the Bible. There are times that God does judge us, and there are times that we go through stuff. He's not forgotten you. You're the hidden treasure. When you're lowly, when you're humbled, when you're broken, you have a hero. And he is singing that he is mighty to save. And I read this story recently that really encapsulated the whole thought behind the book of Zephaniah. It was a story about a great evangelist that we, like Zephaniah, it's the book that no one ever preaches about. Vance Hefner is the evangelist, a world-famous evangelist in America that very rarely gets talked about. Why? After him came Billy Graham. And Billy Graham became the one that everyone talked about. But before Billy Graham, this is a forerunner to Billy Graham. You know that saying that the church is a hospital for sinners, not a museum for saints? Have you heard that? That's a message about Zephaniah, isn't it? Jerusalem are sinners, but God is going to find a way to save it. Apparently, I don't know if it's true, but several sources I read attribute that expression to Vance Hefner. And he tells a story about an evangelistic series he held. This is a facsimile, not the picture. Of an evangelistic series he held, where he preached hard, he was known for preaching hard messages like Zephaniah. He preached a hard message. And he had an altar call. And at that altar call, a woman, Hefner says what he assumed was an educated woman. A wealthy woman. And think about it, in the time, you could tell by dress and so forth. And amongst the crowd, this woman, who he never names in his memoir, comes forward to his altar call. And as he's receiving people in this line of, think about the revival times and the old-fashioned revivals, and everyone's coming up and giving their life back to Jesus. And Hefner says, this rich woman, this wealthy woman, this woman dressed with like to the nines and, you know, well-groomed, she comes up and he stops her. And he looks at her. And he says, "What do you want?" And she says, "I want to be saved." And Hefner says he doesn't know why he said this to her. But he looked at her and he says, "Do you know that you are hell bound for hell? Do you," this is a Zephaniah kind of message, "do you know you're headed to hell?" And she says, "No, I'm not. I'm a good person. I've heard so many sermons saying I'm favored of God. I just want your blessing upon me. I just want to be saved." And he said to her, "Go over there in that pew and sit down, because you're not getting saved." In essence, that's what Zephaniah is saying to Jerusalem. Go sit down into captivity for 70 years. Not today, Jerusalem. So Hefner says in the next verse of the song, you know, they're probably "Just As I Am" or something like that, Marvin, I don't know. In the next verse of the song, it's a good old Baptist revival. More people come forward. And so she tries to come up again. And he says, no, we've already talked. Why do you want to be up here? She says, "I want to be saved." And he looks at her one more time. And he looks at her and he says, "Woman, do you understand? The physician only heals the lethal. The physician only heals the terminal. The physician only heals the sinner. Woman, do you understand that you are hell-bound? And she began to tear up. And he said that he saw she understood. So he said to her again, "Woman, what do you want?" And she again answered the same words, but with a different attitude. "I want to be saved." And he said to her, "Yes, yes, in order to be saved, you must be saved from something." And if you come to Jesus and you say, "I want to be saved," but you don't think there's anything wrong with you, you'll have to sit down. Because in order to have a hero, and that's what our God is, a mighty God, right? He's mighty to save. Our God is a hero who saves. Our God is a warrior who saves. If you need a hero, you must have something you need a hero to save you from. And that's why, not popular, but important, is the book of Zephaniah. Not popular, but important, is the book of Zephaniah. Because Zephaniah speaks to Jerusalem at a point in Jerusalem's history that they have went too far. He set a point, he preached at a point in Israel's history where they had to repent before they could go forward. Zephaniah speaks to Judah and even the crown of Judah, Jerusalem, at a time when Jerusalem has to let go of the Moloch, has to let go of the Baals, has to let go of the Asherah poles in their midst. They have to clean out the temple. They have to find the book, and reinstitute the teachings of the book in their life. I don't know, but I feel like we're there. I don't know, but I feel like America's there. I don't know, but I feel like all the world is there at the moment. It's like, if we don't start to repent, if we don't start to take serious the word of Yahweh, the word of God, the mighty hero who saves us, Jesus the Christ, the don't worship the stars, worship the God who created the stars.
Amen.
If we don't start taking that serious, maybe we live in the time of Josiah. Maybe this is our last chance at reform. Maybe Jesus comes soon. I don't know. Let's not get our Passover wrong, though. Let's yield to our hero. Let's yield to our warrior. Maybe you have something in your life. Maybe you have an Asherah pole you haven't taken down. Maybe you have a final Baal someplace that you're not willing to have cast down. Oh, please, please leave Moloch alone. Maybe you're a hidden treasure. You have a hero. You have a hero. You have a superhero. You have a warrior. Maybe you're past the Asherah pole. Maybe you're past the Baals. Maybe you're past the Molochs. But you know what? Our God, He's mighty. You know what? Our God is mighty. Are you hearing me? You know what? Maybe you're in Babylon already. You don't have to stay in Babylon. Babylon is total confusion. You're like, where did God go? You have a God. He's a hero. You have a God. He's a warrior. You have a God. He is mighty to save, but He needs you to know what you have to be saved from. Today I want to be saved. Today I don't want anything to get in my way of being with Jesus. He's mighty. He's mighty to take down all last idols. Listen to the team. Quietly in your home or wherever you are, ask God, is there something that's keeping me in Babylon? When will my hero come? When will my warrior come? Release me, Jesus.
Everyone needs compassion and love that's never failing. Let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations.
I've been to the Baals. Don't say, last night I stayed up with the Asherah pole. Don't say, I've been to the house of the Lord with Moloch in my heart. Hear the words that the team just sang to you. They sang, take me as you find me. our God is mighty to save. No matter where you are spiritually, be honest with your God. Be honest with Jesus Christ. Be honest with your Savior. Say, save me from the Asherah pole. Save me from the Baals. Take Moloch out of my mind. I'm willing to go to captivity if that's what it takes. But just take me as you find me. If you find me in the temple doing something wrong, if you find me in Babylon waiting out my 70 years, just take me as you find me and be my mighty hero. Come in and save me, because we have a God. We have a God. He's mighty. We have a God. He is a hero. We have a God. He is a warrior, and he will destroy your oppressors. Just like Zephaniah said, he is singing to you. Listen to me, internet. Listen to me, Facebook. Listen to me, YouTube and Praise Vision and wherever else this ends up. Listen to me. There is a God in heaven who is singing to you this morning. Not only do you sing praises to him, but Zephaniah told us he's singing to you. And he's saying, wherever you are, whatever you're going through, whatever the issue is, no matter how bad you think you are, no matter how far down you think you are, no matter you think that you can't ever be worthy of his grace, guess what? Yes, that's right. You're not worthy. Yes, you're right. Judgment is on you. Yes, you're right. As the evangelist Vance Hebner said, you're hellbound. And you may need to sit out because you're hellbound. But guess what? As soon as you realize that, as soon as you can admit that, as soon as you can admit that you have something to be saved from, our God stretches out his hands on that cross. And he is mighty to save, but he can't save you if you don't need him. He can't save you if you won't admit your need of him. As the team sings one last time to you here, come on, bow your heads at home. Come on, bow. Even if you can't, if you're someplace where you don't want to bow your head, just in the quietness of your mind, come on. Tell Jesus what's going to happen to you unless he saves you. Because that's the point that he comes in to save. He's singing to you right now to tell you, yes, there is a strong message of judgment coming, but I will save you even in the strong message of judgment. I will save you even when the world falls apart. I will save you no matter what the pandemic does to your livelihood, no matter what it does to your family, no matter what it does. I am in the business of going to war against Asherah. I'm in the business of going to war against Moloch. I am in the business of even taking on the Babylonians and freeing you. You just got to call on and know you are hell bound and you need a mighty God who saves.
Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save.
Light and let the whole world see.
Jesus conquered.